IVM.
Welcome to All Things Policy, a daily podcast by the Takshashila Institution. We are a bunch of policy nerds based in Bengaluru, and we like bringing fresh perspectives to Indian affairs and Indian perspectives to global affairs. So grab a cup of coffee, sit back, and join us for today's chat.
Hello and welcome to All Things Policy. Joseph R. Biden Jr. is slated to become the 46th President of the United States on the 20th of January next year. And in the weeks to come, he's going to start assembling his cabinet, pick his advisors, and these are the people who are going to steer his foreign policy over the following 4 years. Now, obviously, all of this is going to be very closely watched in India, just like we've been closely watching the election. And there's going to be a lot of speculation. What we want to focus on today in this episode is how Joseph Biden's administration will deal with China. There are people who believe he's going to go soft on them. There are people who, seem to basically think this is time for the Avengers to assemble, as Manoj likes to put it. So to discuss this, of course, I have with me today Manoj and Suyash, our two China hands. Let's start with you, Manoj. China has not, as of this recording, even acknowledged the election of Joe Biden. We're recording this on the afternoon of the 10th. Now, what can we expect from a Biden administration? Are they going to get tougher on China, play nice, or is it really just going to be more of the same?
Hey, Aditya. This is really interesting as to how this has played out. I think even the Chinese are at the moment sort of contemplating what to expect with the Joe Biden administration. And I think they're at the moment even contemplating about waiting it out to see whether there is a Joe Biden administration that comes into place, given what's going on in the U.S. with regard to these legal cases and all. Now, one would assume that this will get settled sometime by December, which is when official tallies have to come in the U.S., with states submitting their official tallies and eventually meetings happening to formally get the presidency, wrapped up. So I presume that at the moment they are waiting. The Chinese haven't really acknowledged. They've basically said that the foreign ministry said on Monday, that which is the 9th, that we note that he's claimed victory, and we'll follow official protocols in issuing our statements and whatever, which basically means that we are going to wait it out. And I think that from their point of view is fairly sensible. It allows them to keep this argument alive that we don't interfere in domestic affairs of other states. And at the other end, it also sort of keeps probably Trump relaxed for the period of 70, 75 days that he's going to be in power still. And he can take decisions. I mean, the fact that he just fired his own defense secretary even after losing the elections. I mean, taking that sort of a decision when you're in transition also seems strange. But he made that decision, right? So I think they're just waiting it out because they don't want to see anything adverse coming from Trump also. And it allows them in the meantime, domestically, for the narrative to continue to undermine democratic processes and sell that this is chaotic to your domestic audiences. I mean, just through the last week when you had the election play out in China, just like everywhere else in the world is watching as to what's been happening in the U.S., officially, Beijing kept silent, yet sort of, you saw lots of discussion online on social media. I think some numbers, right, on Weibo as of November 5th, which is 3 days after the election, you had about 7 billion views for the hashtag, U.S. elections, U.S. presidential election. You had multiple discussions stoked up by state media. The People's Daily on Twitter went ahead and retweeted Trump's claim about having won the election with an emoji or with a laughing emoji. On Weibo, you had People's Daily starting discussion threads talking about how American voters were deeply divided. You had Chinese scholars and academics talking about how the U.S. system is, and I'm quoting this, stale and aging. You had others saying that, look, even if the election ends the way it ends, the majority of the Chinese can see that there is so much political division, economic stagnation and social turmoil in the U.S. and that doesn't end with one election. Hu Shijin, the editor of the Global Times, was very categorical on social media in China, saying things like the U.S. system is in a state of degradation. So they use this, so while parts of the world might look at what's happening in the U.S. and be confused and say this is absurd, There are other parts who will say that, look, this is what democracy is. You calculate every vote, and this is what the process is like, and you follow due process. For the Chinese, this chaos, you know, focusing on protests and the rest of it, has been about buttressing your own sort of claims about, look, how efficient our system is. So to me, this delay in acknowledgement and all plays out, you know, supports this narrative that, you know, it's a chaotic system. We're going to stay away, let them decide. And on the sort of practical level, it allows them not to annoy Trump, who may be still holding power for the next 77 years. Broadly, what a Biden administration could entail, in some ways, it's, you know, Biden's, this election has been not won or spoken. I mean, foreign policy has not been the biggest aspect of this election. Unlike, let's say, you know, 2008, when Obama was getting elected, or even last time around when Trump was elected, China was a factor because it was made a factor in terms of the economic issues in America. In 2008, you had Obama talking about foreign wars. So foreign policy played a role, along with, of course, the financial crisis. In this election, you didn't see foreign policy being front and center. The discussion on China was essentially about Biden saying, yes, of course, China is a competitor, but I'll deal with them smartly, unlike what Trump has dealt with them. And we need to work with allies and not alienate our allies. So in that sense, I can see the optimism that people have that, you know, Biden will repair ties with, you know, this transatlantic alliance. And you will have, like you said, the Avengers come together to take on China and Russia. But I'm sort of not of the opinion that that's as straightforward. And neither do I think that a Biden administration will be particularly hard in the sort of short term. It has lots of domestic priorities. But what you can see is a far more, hopefully far more thought out competition with China. Because this is not about a Cold War. This is a much, much more different competition. And perhaps we can talk about that going forward.
Suyash, you want to add something?
Yes. So I disagree slightly with Manoj. I've been following presidential debates. China was one of the major factors, if not the major factors, because a lot of debates surrounded China. And with the implied thing, because coronavirus, the narrative that was being formed in the US debates for across bipartisan narrative was that corona came out of Wuhan, and that's why China is a big factor. This is the point where I disagree with Manoj. Going ahead, I agree with Manoj on this latter part, that Democrats wouldn't be harsher than the previous administration on China, because the things that Trump has done, in most cases, it has peaked out. So going forward, Democrats would be equivalently harsh or maybe softer on China. For example, I'll give you a few examples. In case of South China Sea, I don't see what else they can do other than the things that they are doing. They are already engaging in FONOPS operation. They have already sanctioned so many companies. Similarly, in case of Taiwan, they are already going closer to Taiwan. And this is also, and this has also come. So before, in the Obama administration, Joe Biden was the head of the Senate's Foreign Policy Committee. And during his administration and later on as one of the leaders of opposition, he has taken a similar line as what Trump had taken in case of Taiwan. So it would be an extension. This administration would be at least an extension in policies on Taiwan and South China Sea, if not anything else. So I don't see a major drastic change on security issue in case of the upcoming administration.
Just to make this interesting, I'll also disagree with you slightly, Suyash. What I'll say is that what this administration could do differently, we obviously don't know, is that they could choose not to, for example, initiate a trade war with South Korea, like Donald Trump's administration did, or they could help South Korea and Japan patch up their differences, which, you know, because of American lack of attention and inactiveness about this, you know, that relationship has gone downhill. Also, because a Trump administration may engage more consistently with its allies and with its partners, that itself could become a form of pressure on China. So yeah, those are just some thoughts.
Just adding to what you said, Aditya, in case of trade, I agree completely with, because Trump's confrontation or Trump's approach towards China in the first half of his presidency was on emphasizing on trade. And it started with trade negotiations, and then his approach was towards trade war. And others, security part or technology part came, technology problems came in late, in its later, especially after early 2019. So yes, I agree with you that trade policy, perhaps there could be divergence in what Trump's approach towards trade was, or in comparison to what Biden's approach towards trade would be or would be. But in case of security, I think it would be an extension of Trump's policy, because he has gone so ahead that I don't see a way back. And that is because of American public opinion as well, because Wuhan came out of American public opinion, or the world public opinion, is more likely fixated on that China is responsible for the virus. Also, the things that China is doing on its periphery. And I don't see any politician, popularly elected politician, going against that public opinion. So I don't see anything happening on security, drastically different happening on security. But I agree with the trade part that you have said.
I think it'd be a good thing for me to just clarify what I meant when I said that, you know, the elections were not about, that foreign policy was not the key issue. So Suresh, I think the point that got mistranslated is the fact that I didn't say that China was not part of the conversation. But my point was that this was more about a domestic situation in America. You know, this was not a foreign policy election, or foreign policy didn't play the kind of role that it did in, say, 2008 or the last time around when China became one of the central sort of factors, apart from many other things. The fact that American public opinion across the board is unfavorable of China is point, I think, is very well taken. And this is a bipartisan view. I mean, if you go back to April, there was a Pew survey which showed that, you know, favorability ratings of China. I mean, 62% of Democrats had an unfavorable view of China. 72% of Republicans had an unfavorable view of China. These were at historic highs since the surveys began back in 2005. So, of course, there's a different approach towards China. And yes, the fact that there was a sense that this virus came from China, that created even more sort of animation politically. The fact that there was some sort of an influence operation, the facts that there was a sense of China trying to influence domestic debate in the U.S. I mean, if you just go even before the pandemic, Mike Pence's speech at the Hudson Institute talked about things like Chinese influence operations, plants in media, and so on and so forth, Confucius Institutes and the rest of it. And subsequently, we've seen action on all of that. We've seen a structured effort by the Department of Justice in the U.S. tackle espionage cases specifically related to China. And over the last couple of years, there have been significant number of detentions, some quite problematic, but there have been significant number of detentions. There's been a pushback against Chinese students and the rest of it, which tells you that society has shifted from where it was, say, 4, 5, 6 years ago. And that shift is not going to move away from China at any point soon. So that, I think, is well taken. That's why I agree with you that Biden will be tougher than one would assume. Yet, will the policy be significantly different? So on trade, I agree with Aditya, that there will be some coordination, and there's much more that he can do to work with allies, South Korea and Japan. There's much more that he can do to, you know, get along better with the Canadians, with the Germans, with the French, and, you know, have much more coordinated action on trade with regard to China. The reason why I sort of find this, you know, the amount of coordination that can take place and what that could eventually yield and the kind of pressure that could yield, that's where I am sort of skeptical. And the reason is because if you go back to what's happened through this year, Europe has had plenty of opportunities to put pressure on China and to tell China that, look, you know, on human rights, on trade, we find this behavior problematic. And at times they have. Right. So through the pandemic, Europe has had this debate about Chinese influence. Chinese embassies in Europe have been extremely active in pushing back against European media outlets for the coverage that they were doing. There have been legal changes in Europe with regard to foreign investment. And those legal changes happened not only because of China, but also at one point of time, Trump threatening to, you know, invest heavily and therefore corner vaccine makers in Germany and vaccine research in Germany. So this sort of concern about autonomy and your own security and your own economic security came from every side. And I think even that sort of conversation has shifted in Europe. You won't see Europe also going back to the point saying, okay, now Trump's gone, let's go back to the way we were with the US. You know, we are part of NATO and this common threat and so on and so forth. Because Europe sees big business opportunities with China. Through this pandemic, through what's happened in Hong Kong, through what's happened in Xinjiang, you've seen statements from the EU, you've seen statements from EU member states, but you've seen zero action. And you've seen zero commitment to action. You know, to the point that the last dialogue that the Chinese had, that Xi Jinping had with Merkel and the EU, Xi Jinping explicitly told them, we don't want you to instruct us on human rights. We don't need instructors on this. So the idea that, you know, there will be coordinated action on trade, on values and this and that, to me is a little bit. And at the same time, the Europeans are saying that we want to conclude this investment treaty. Yes, we are disillusioned. We've seen tremendous promises from China, and all of these promises have remained unfulfilled for such a long period of time. Yet they want that investment treaty to end. If you see surveys that have come out from European Chambers of Commerce in China, barely any European companies are considering shifting out of China. In fact, the last EU Chamber survey said that there was concern about all sorts of issues. Yet, if you look at how they talk about the openness of the Chinese market across different sectors, they rate it fairly highly. So there's lots of value that European businesses see from China. So therefore, I think this business of, you know, you will see a coordinated action, and this coordinated action will yield significant pressure on China, I'm a little skeptical of. You will see obviously far greater coordination than what you saw under Trump. What that would yield, I think we should sort of wait and see. So that's where on security, my thought is that I agree with Suresh, right? I don't see Obama sold weapons to Taiwan, Trump's selling weapons to Taiwan. I think Biden will continue that policy. The fact that the US just this week has gone public with American Marines in a drill involved in Taiwan, a drill that happens routinely, yet for the first time genuinely sort of publicly acknowledged and publicized, is something that's important. It's a signal to the Chinese. I think that's an important area to watch out for in terms of whether I don't see significant changes, and what can the US do in the South China Sea is another matter. Also, one needs to see if faced with a severe economic crisis, faced with a severe social crisis in the US, and obviously political turmoil at this point of time, do we see Biden reticent to use force abroad, to project force abroad? And in the context of China, particularly if he wants economic trade-offs with the Chinese. I mean, those are the kind of things that we have to see. The one thing that we will probably not see from Biden, and I think the Chinese will be quite thrilled about this, is that you will not see Mike Pompeo as the foreign minister, as Secretary of State. I mean, given the fact that through the last year, Mike Pompeo has been public enemy number one in China, they'd be quite happy with him gone. And therefore, you will see a different tone to the relationship. And I think Beijing will welcome that. Let's see what happens with the Huawei case with Meng Wanzhou in Canada, and what happens with the extradition request, how the Biden administration moves ahead with that, and consequently what happens with the Michael Corvig and Michael Spavor in China. Those are the kind of things that will tell you if something really changes in that over the next 3, 4, 5 months, once the Biden administration takes charge. That those are the kind of things that will tell you whether the tone of the relationship will be adversarial, ideological or not. I don't know what will happen with that, but my sense is that how Trump officials cast the relationship over the last year, from Pompeo to Pottinger, talking about an ideological rivalry, an ideological Cold War in some ways. I don't think Biden's administration will be casting it in that light. Another way where it can compete better, and where it needs to compete better, is to actually invest in American competitiveness in things like 5G, AI, emerging technologies. And I think that's where the long-term challenge of the Biden administration can come to Beijing. Not from short-term disruptions, but rather from long-term investment in American capabilities. And if that's what they are able to achieve, I think therefore the Chinese will see the Biden administration as a long-term challenge, in contrast to what Trump would have presented, which was tremendous unreliability, tremendous damage, but also at the same time, tremendous damage to U.S. social fabric, U.S. economic fabric, and U.S. competitiveness on sort of.
So Manoj, you ended your point with how much more damage can be done. I agree with you, because a Biden administration, if at all it happens, is still 3 months away, and Trump is going down, if he's going down with the thought that Wuhan and China are responsible for the defeat of Trump administration, which is up to a certain extent true. So in that case, how much more damage could happen in China and US relations in next 3 months? And as we had discussed just before the podcast, yesterday or day before yesterday, he fired Mark Esper. And if he can do such, he can do such things after not winning the race, what can the damage be in the future course of next 3 months?
Yeah, my thought on that is that I think that's what the Chinese are also wondering, right? They are sort of, they don't want to antagonize Trump because he's still in power for the next 70-75 days. But at the same time, I think my sense is this, that a lot of the focus will be on domestic issues for Trump, and you know, the fact that he's making these legal challenges. that will be the focus going forward for him. And what the Chinese are doing is that they're just waiting it out. Now, of course, anything can happen. But my sense is that, you know, look, Biden is a known commodity to the Chinese. And to be honest, Xi Jinping is a known commodity to Biden. They've met each other a significant number of times. And they seem to have a sense of each other. So that's why I think that in the next 70, 75 days, obviously anything can happen. And the Chinese will be very cautious about that because you don't want to give somebody mercurial just think of it this way. The elections were happening last week. And while the elections were happening, the State Department delisted the East Turkestan Islamist Movement as a terrorist group. So it no longer recognizes this as a terrorist group. And it said that there is no sufficient evidence for us to do this anymore. So some of these steps that have been taken, my sense is that the Biden administration, as and when it comes to power, will not go back on this. Or even if it does go back on some of these to placate the Chinese, there will be a pound of flesh that it will drop. And Trump's given them that. That is why I think the Chinese also sort of worry about, you know, what can Trump do over the next 75 days? He can create more chaos for us. And we can avoid that chaos by not getting involved as much as possible until things seem apparent or the power shift in the US seems to have essentially happened, even though not formally haven't taken. And I think that's what they are trying to do. As far as, you know, yes, Trump may feel that the Chinese cost him the election. And yes, of course, the handling of the pandemic is one of the sort of critical factors in his loss in the election. But I don't see Trump's ire at present publicly being directed at the Chinese. I think the ire is directed domestically at the Democrats. And that's because for a lot of the Republican Party, you're also looking at 2024. And for 2024, the narrative that they stole the election, and possibly they stole the election with Chinese assistance might work better. At the moment, they're not talking about the Chinese aspect at all. At the moment, all they're talking about is the fact that there were fraudulent votes cast. And I think that is a narrative that they want to go ahead with in the future because that might help in other areas politically. So while China, yes, the virus and all was a problem for them, you know, I don't think that's necessarily something that's going to hold off for a very long period of time. What the narrative that will hold off much more from a Republican point of view is the fact that there were fraudulent votes rather than that. The only other point that I should also mention, Suresh, you had spoken about how world opinion about China is negative. I think we need to be very careful about this. So again, in October, you had a Pew survey which showed you that, you know, across much of the developed world, the Western Europe and US and South Korea, again, opinions with regard to China, favorability ratings are at historic lows. In India also, favorability ratings are at historic lows. That's there. And it talks about the failure. This is a reflection of the failure of Chinese foreign policy through the pandemic. You know, for making tactical gains, they've made strategic losses. Yet, this does not capture sentiment in Latin America, in the rest of Asia, and even significantly in East Asia, which has ASEAN has emerged China's biggest economic partner through the pandemic. You know, in the Middle East, in Africa, where China has a much bigger role. So when we say the world needs to be the world. And I think that's not necessarily entirely the case. And you can see that from the fact that, you know, you had the UN Human Rights Council meeting in October, competing letters issued by different sides. The Chinese are always able to gather many more countries to their side because of their economic diplomacy, vaccine diplomacy, and the rest of it. So I don't think the world is that divided or the world is that critical. But yes, the Chinese have made serious mistakes to lose trust and support in Western Europe and with the US and its allies, Australia, South Korea, Japan. In that sense, it's made strategic blunders. And that is something for Beijing to reflect on. I mean, to my understanding, Beijing has been its worst enemy over the last couple of years.
All right. So we've talked about personalities. We've talked about Joe Biden, Xi Jinping. But I think we also do understand that, that there are some consistencies in American foreign policy, right? And in America's own priorities today, across the political spectrum, American politicians seem to have been very skeptical in the last few years about, for example, the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And they've been left out of the RCEP. American politicians haven't really been committed to renegotiating the terms of world trade. They've not been adventurous about new trade agreements. And there's also some sort of emerging bipartisan consensus about, at least about China being some sort of significant challenge to the US. Having said that, I also do get the sense, Manoj, that in the broader ecosystem of the Democratic Party, there is a sense that China is this more responsible power. And also combined with that, since 2016, the whole business of Russian interference in the US election, the Democrats have basically turned on Russia. So they're really angry with Russia, and they seem to go more easy on China. So does it matter? How much does it matter for the Chinese which advisors, which cabinet members Biden picks for his administration?
So I think it matters, right? I think it matters because the team that Trump had put together, I mean, from Pompeo to Lighthizer, it told you, I mean, Steven Mnuchin was still sort of, was not as rough for the Chinese, but Pompeo and Lighthizer particularly told you that, you know, Trump was very clear that he wants to take China on. And Trump made that very clear when he was getting elected last time around. That, you know, he will, you know, his whole thing was the day one that I'm in office, I'll label China as a currency manipulator. You've not seen that sort of stuff from the Democrats. I mean, in fact, let me just quote what Biden said at during an interview with 60 Minutes, right? He talks about the biggest threat to America now in terms of breaking up our security alliances is Russia. And China was the US's biggest competitor. That's what he called China, right? The biggest competitor. And he said that depending on how we handle that relationship with China, it would determine whether we would enter into more serious competition relating to force. These are his words. So it tells you a little bit about the fact that, you know, broad-based Democratic supporters, Democrat Party supporters, and even legislators have this sense that, have a much lower opinion of China historically than they've ever had. The threat that they see largely is from the Russians. And I think that's, like you said, you know, an experience of what happened in 2016 carrying forward. That sense is really, really important. Also, there are different wings of the Democratic Party, right? There'd be wings which have deep sort of business interests and which are sort of, you know, linked to Wall Street and therefore have sort of interests in maintaining stability in the relationship with China. At the same time, you will have this sort of, you know, what's called the far left, the progressive, whatever you want to call it, wing of the Democratic Party, which would want to take serious action on things like values, human rights, so on and so forth, the kind of thing that, you know, one would think of. So I don't know how that will essentially play out. But my sense is that, you know, there will be a trade-off and a balance between this value business and economics. And I think there will still be severe competition, and the Democrats will be interested in that severe competition. But for instance, I don't assume that they will be as trigger happy as the Republicans have been under Trump to sort of launch national security probes against Chinese companies. My sense is that Chinese companies might get a breather, at least in that sense, in the US. Yet you might see tougher regulation on things like data, because that's what Biden wants to focus on, right? Getting the domestic architecture right. I am hopeful that they will see sense on things like immigration, on things like research partnerships. Yet I think the sort of ship has sailed that this will happen without security checks. So there will be stricter protocols and measures for security checks, on there will be stricter, narrower definitions of what can fall under broader definitions of what can fall under national security, and narrower freedom for research collaboration and things like that. So some of those things, I think the consensus across parties, across sort of bipartisan consensus exists, and I think those will continue. But I still think that there will be a trade-off between, you know, what's good from a business point of view, to values, to security, with a greater focus on, yes, you don't want to undermine security, but your economy is linked to your security, and that sort of development is linked to your security. So therefore, some of those trade-offs might be accepted. It won't be the Clinton trade-off. I was reading recently this book, Superpower Competition. I can't remember the name. It is by Ling Ling Wei and Bob Davies from the Wall Street Journal. And it's about the trade war. And they talk about the Clinton era and this sort of debate within the Democratic Party about the trade-off with regard to values. And this is Clinton after Tiananmen. And this issue of values and the issue of trade and the trade-off that the Democratic Party eventually makes, which eventually allowed the Chinese to enter the World Trade Organization. And I think you're seeing something similar. But the thing is that the political boat on that is sort of sailed. There is an acknowledgement within the US that, you know, China is a competitor. It's a system that's not going to change. That theory of evolution to democracy through economic development is not going to happen. So you can't go back to business as usual, but you need to do some degree of adjustment because of your multiple business interests, so that you don't launch these random trade wars, hurt yourself also without really achieving anything strategic. And I think that's a challenge in terms of how policy comes out. That's a bit of a waffle. It's not really an answer. But yeah, that's the best that I can come up with at this point of time.
Yeah, we are going to waffle at this time because we don't know what the future really holds. But thank you so much, Manoj and Suyash. This bilateral relationship between the US and China is probably going to change in some ways in the coming years, remain the same also in other ways. And we can be sure that in India, this is going to be met by concern in some ways and approval at other times. Whatever it is, we'll continue watching this space, and we'll also consider the significance of the Biden administration on India more directly. Thank you so much for joining us, Manoj and Suyash.
Thanks.
And thank you for joining us on All Things Policy.
If you liked our show, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can tune into them on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or wherever you listen to your podcasts. You can also follow IVM on social media. The handle is @IVM Podcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And hey, if you'd like to dive into Takshashila's research on technology, strategy, and economic affairs, check us out at our Twitter handle @TakshashilaInst or our website takshashila.org.in.
I hope you enjoyed that show. If you aren't following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. It's been a really, really great week on the network. Let me make a couple of recommendations to you guys. Avastation Adulthood, they have an extraordinary episode on relationships. Ritasha and Ayushi, as always, do a bang-up job. I think you'll really enjoy that conversation. Check out Edges and Sledges, where DJ Ashwin and Varun have been talking to fans from different IPL teams on every episode. It's a really, really interesting project they've taken on during the course of the IPL. And as it comes to a conclusion, I'm sure you'll love to hear the thoughts on the tournament as a whole. I want to mention Uncle Please Sit. They had a really great episode which dove into why is pollution so bad. And I think that given the circumstances we're dealing with right now, it makes a ton of sense to listen to that. Cyrus had a really great week on his show as well. On the Monday episode, he spoke to Raj and DK about all kinds of stuff. He was in one of their early movies. Definitely a fun conversation. Do check that out. And finally, let me talk to you about The Wire Talks with Siddharth Bhatia. We're very excited about this show. On the first episode, Jairam Ramesh is there having conversation with Siddharth Bhatia about the legacy of Indira Gandhi. I think you will really, really get something out of this. Do give it a listen. And with that, I hope to see you again next week.
Are you constantly seeking happiness? Wondering how to make the most of every day? How not to let your inhibitions stop you from achieving your goals? It's now time to get your A-game on. It's time to unlock your true potential. Tune in to the empowering series with me, Zarina Poonawalla, to feel empowered in all genres of life. From behavioral skills to management skills, from health to relationships, from mental well-being to emotional well-being, and of course your finances. I've got you covered. With these tips and tricks from me, Zarina, and true life stories from my amazing guests, you're bound to bring your purest to the table. Tune in to the empowering series with Zarina Poonawalla every Thursday on the IVM Podcast app, website, or wherever you listen to podcasts.